Hello, welcome to the Pen Drive, G Drive and VOD course of Signals and Systems. So I hope you have watched the lectures on Gate Academy Global YouTube channel. If you don't have watched that lecture still, there is nothing to worry about. We are going to discuss the things from very, very basics here. But still, if you want to recall that, then we have just seen that signal can be expressed mathematically as function of one or more independent variable. If function is in the syllabus of Signals and System, normally the independent variable that you are going to take is time. So if signal is function of one independent variable only, then it is called as one dimensional signal. As you say, like voltage signal or current signal that you write at as Vt or I of t. So these are one dimensional signal, as these signals are depending only on one variable, that is time. If signal is depending on more than one variable, one variables, like if you see picture signal, then picture signal depends on two variables, that is, therefore it can be said that signal is two dimensional signal because it is depending on two independent variables. Similarly, if you watch a video, then this video signal depends on three variables. Now, it is function of time also. Therefore, this signal is a three-dimensional signal. But fortunately, we have to study only one-dimensional signal in the syllabus. Throughout the syllabus, we will be discussing only one-dimensional signal. And particularly, that one independent variable that we are going to take will be time. So, what we have seen that we have classified signal on the primary basis that we can classify signals in four types. The first type was continuous in time and continuous in value. It was the first type. Again, you have seen the second type as continuous in time but discrete in value. Then you saw the third type, that is discrete in time, discrete in time but continuous in value. And then the next type was discrete in both, discrete in both time as well as in value, time and value. So we have seen that if a signal is continuous in time and value, the meaning of continuity is if you are observing a signal from a leftmost limit to rightmost limit of time, then this signal must be present at every instant, or it can be defined as every instant of time, then it is said to be a continuous in time signal. Similarly, if the values that are taken by the signal can be any value, it can be integer, it can be a fractional value, then it is known to be a continuous in value signal. So you have seen these four types of signals. Particularly if you see here, if the continuity is maintained in any one of the domain, then the signal is known to be analog signal. If you see here, this signal is continuous in both in time and value, this signal is continuous in time, this signal is continuous in value. So in these three signals, there is continuity maintained in at least one domain. So all of these three signals, all of these three signals are said to be analog signals. All these three signals are analog signals. Particularly, if you see, these two signals are continuous in time, therefore these two signals are continuous time analog signal. While if you see here, the third type, it is discrete time analog signal. We have seen that this signal is obtained when you perform sampling on any continuous time signal, and in the process of sampling, what you do is you take values of signal, continuous time signal x of t, at integer multiples of sampling interval. Therefore, the signal that you are going to obtain will not be defined at every instant of time, but it will be defined only at the integer multiples of ts duration of time. Therefore, if you see that, if you say that it is a block of sampler, let it is a sampler block, so what you are going to take, if you are applying a continuous time signal x of t, let it is a continuous time signal, let we have taken the example something like this, let it is your signal x of t, and you are going to sample this signal, then the meaning of sampling is you are just going to multiply this signal, you are going to multiply this signal x of t with an impulse train that is something like this, let it is an impulse train which is having regular impulses at regular intervals of time from minus infinity to plus infinity, let it is your signal p of t, we have seen all of these in earlier lectures, so let it is t, and if these impulses are occurring at every ts duration, that is ts, 2ts and so on, Similarly, here also minus Ts, minus 2Ts and so on. Then we have seen that if we'll be multiplying these two signals, then the values, if area of all of the impulses is 1, then after multiplication, 1 multiplied with anything, you will be having the values of signals x of t only, but now this signal is continuous in time, that is it is defined at all the instants of time earlier. But if you are going to multiply this signal with this impulse train, then now the resultant signal will also be defined only at these intervals, that is Ts, 2Ts, 3Ts and so on. Therefore, if you are going to take sampling of any continuous time signal, then the output is equals to x of nts, that is now this x of t is not going to defined at every instant of time, but it is going to be defined only at integer multiples of ts. Therefore, after sampling, this x of t signal converts into x of nts, where these n will be any integer starting from minus infinity to plus infinity. These values can be any values. So now if you sample any continuous time signal, then you are going to get the values of this signal x of t only, but at instants where time t is integer multiples of ts. So for the sampling purpose, you just have to replace this t whatever the function is written. Suppose you are given x of t is a function that is equals to t square, then or you say that the function is t into cos of t, let it is a continuous time function t into cos of t, and you have given that we are sampling this signal using a sampler or using an impulse train of sampling frequency. Let it is given as sampling frequency f of s is 4 hertz. Then what is sampling frequency? You have seen that by the meaning of sampling frequency, you understand that it is the frequency of this impulse train with which you are sampling your continuous time signal. And what is the meaning of this frequency of impulse train? Let impulses are occurring at every ts duration of time, therefore you can say that the time period, it is a periodic signal, as it is existing from minus infinity to plus infinity, whereas it is repeating itself after every ts time duration, therefore you can say it is a periodic signal. Having time period, it is its time period after which it is repeating itself, so the time period of this impulse train is ts, and you know that from the relation between time period and frequency, this Ts is going to be 1 upon Fs. If we consider Fs to be the frequency of this impulse train, then Fs is related with this time period, Ts is equals to 1 upon Fs. You don't have any need to worry about the time period or frequency, as we will be discussing in very much detail in further lectures. But for the time being, I am just telling to let you understand that what is the process of sampling actually means is, you are taking a continuous time signal and you are multiplying that signal with an impulse train. And by the name of sampling frequency, you just have to understand that it is the frequency of the impulse train, that is a periodic signal, and which is used for the sampling process. So if the time period of this impulse train is Ts, then frequency Fs would be Ts is equals to 1 upon Fs, or Fs is equals to 1 upon Ts. So what you have to do is, for the sampling process, you must have to replace this continuous variable t by a discrete variable, that is nts. You have to replace t by nts, and then you are going to get x of t as x of nts. But usually it is not written x of nts, it is simply written as x of n. So if you have to find a discrete time signal corresponding to any analog signal, continuous time signal, let it is given that x of t is equals to t cos t, and you have to find output of a sampler for which sampling frequency is 4 kilohertz, then what you have to do is, you have to calculate this value of Ts. So if Fs is equals to 4 kilohertz, then Ts is equals to what? 1 upon Fs, that is equals to 1 upon 4, and the unit of time period is seconds. So you have just to replace this T by nts. So if x of t we have taken t into cos t, then x of nts, we will have to replace t by nts into cos of nts. And now we have already obtained the values of ts, therefore the value will be n into ts is equals to 1 by 4, so it will be n by 4 cos of n by 4, as this signal may or may not be periodic. See, we will be seeing further that if a continuous time signal is periodic, then it is not necessary then that its counterpart, that is discrete time counterpart, will also be periodic. But for the time being, we are just seeing the procedure of sampling. So for the procedure of sampling, you must have to replace continuous variable t by nts. See, these topics are actually the topics that we have to cover in further lectures in detail. So if you are not getting all the points, then there is nothing to be get confused, as these portions we will not going to use this portion just right now. So just recall the concepts of sampling. You must have understood, you must have studied these in your university lectures also. So you just have to replace this continuous variable t by nts for the process of sampling. So when you perform sampling on a continuous time signal, then you obtain a discrete time but continuous in value signal. So this signal is again a example of analog signal, but it is a discrete time analog signal, while these two signals are continuous time analog signal. A signal is said to be digital only if it is quantized in both time as well as in value. Therefore, if you see this signal, which is obtained after sampling and quantization, this particular signal is only the example of digital signal. It is only the example of digital signal. Rest of the three signals are analog signals. Two are continuous time analog signal, and this third one is discrete time analog signal. This one is digital signal, that is discretized in both time and as well as in value. So now if you see, there is one more classification, that is continuous time signal and discrete time signal. So how you get discrete time signal from continuous time signal? We have just discussed that process. Sampling is the only tool by which you can convert a continuous time signal into a discrete time signal. So if you want to see the procedure to convert continuous time signal into discrete time signal. As the topic that we are going to discuss is operations on signals, so before starting operations on signals, we must have to understand what are different types of signals. Therefore, we have discussed basic four types of signals, and now we are taking one more classification, that is continuous time signals and discrete time signals. So how you convert a continuous time signal into a discrete time signal? It is the process that is, at first you take a continuous time signal, that is let your signal x of t, let it is signal x of t. Then you apply this signal into a sampler. You apply this signal into a sampler which will be having some sampling frequency, and you know that this sampling frequency is nothing but the frequency of impulse train that is being used for the sampling process. So this sampler will have some TS or FS, and to find out the output of this sampler, you just have to replace T by N into TS. This N will be varying from minus infinity to plus infinity, but this TS will be a constant value that will be given to you as either TS or FS. So now you can calculate the signal here, that is x of nts, which is simply written to be as x of n. Now if you see this signal is a discrete time signal, but if you see here, if you are just going to replace t by nts, then there can be any value of x of t that can come into x of n. That is, if let ts is 1 seconds, so there will be values of x of n at 1 second, 2 second, 3 seconds, that is integer multiples of 1 seconds. So if suppose the value of x of t at t is equals to 3 seconds is 4.5. So if you are going to sample this signal by 1 second time interval, so you will be having that value at t is equals to 3 seconds, that is equals to 4.5, that is not an integer. Therefore, if the amplitudes may or may not be integer, then you name this signal as continuous in amplitude signal. What is discrete in amplitude signals? Discrete in value signals means if the signal is discrete in value, then its amplitude can only be an integer. But if the amplitude or the value can be integer as well as fraction, then you name this signal as a continuous in value signal. Therefore, here you have obtained a discrete time signal, but this discrete time signal is, or it may be continuous in value. So if you want to find a digital signal, then the next process is you pass out this discrete time signal, which is now continuous in value. It is applied into a quantizer, and we have seen the process of quantization also. We will be seeing further in detail this process of quantization. But for the time being, you know that if we pass the signal x of n, let it is our signal x of n, which is having values 4.6, let it is 4.4, let it is 5.2, and let it is 4.5 or 4.51. So, if you are going to quantize this value of signal, it is our signal x of n with respect to n. Now, if you see here, in the discrete time signal, we should mention this axis at nts, but it is understood that ts is present. Therefore, you just write it n here, and if you have to find out the value that at t is equals to how much second, the value is 4.4. So, it is n is equals to 1. It is n is equals to 2, it is equals to 3. But the actual time instant for this n is equals to 1 is 1 into Ts. It, for 2, it is 2 into Ts. And for 3, it is 3 into Ts. But it is understood that Ts is multiplied. So, for representation purposes, we just write this x-axis as n, and we write the values of signal x of n with respect to n only. So, now, if you see here, values are the amplitudes are not only integers, but these are containing fractions also. So, when you pass this same signal from a quantizer, then what the quantizer do is, it will quantize, or you can say it will discretize the value of amplitudes. That is, now the values will only be integers. And you know the process of quantization, we have discussed it, that after quantization, you will be having the signal that is a discrete time signal x of n, which will be continuous. That is, if the quantization boundary is between 4 and 5, it will be 4.5, 5 and 6, the quantization boundary will be, or decision boundary will be 5.5. So, if the signal is greater than 4.5, then you are going to take this value as 5. So, this value at n equals to 0, we have taken this value to be 5. As this value is less than 4.5, so it will be taken as 4. So, we have taken this value to be 4 at n is equals to 1, it is the point at n is equals to 0. Similarly, at n is equals to 2, the value is 5.2, which is less than 5.5. Therefore, again, this value is going to be taken as 5. So, it is 5. Again, if you see here, it is 4.51, that is greater than 4.5. So, you must have to take this value again as 5. So, it is your discrete time, discrete in time and discrete in value signal, which is a perfectly digital signal, and it is known to be a digital signal which is having values at n is equals to 2 and 3 as all the values are integers. So, it is the basic process to convert a continuous time signal into a discrete time signal. So, if you have to see the representations of discrete time signals, then discrete time signal, it is not necessary that discrete time signals have integer amplitudes only. So, only digital signals, it is compulsorily that the values of amplitudes of digital signal will only be the integers. But all discrete time signals will have integers, integer amplitude, it is not a necessary fact. So, if you see representation of discrete time signals. If some of you are studying in the third semester, and if you have never seen these concepts, then still you don't have to worry about. We are just completing this topic, and we will be moving for the next topic that will be completely understood by all of you, and you will be gaining concepts, and when you revise your notes, then you can easily understand what we have discussed. So, if you see the representation of discrete time signal, then the first representation that we are going to take is graphical representation. Graphical representation. It is the same that we have drawn here. It is known to be the graphical representation. That is, if you represent a signal, let it is with respect to n, you are representing any discrete time signal x of n, which is having values 2.1, let it is minus 1 at n is equals to 0, let it is 1.8. At n is equals to 1, let it is 2.4, n is equals to 2, let it is again minus 1, then it is let 2 for n is equals to 0, it is the point where n is equals to 1, at this point n is equals to 2, at this point this access value, n values will be integers only, 0, 1, 2, 3, that is signal can be present, a discrete time signal can be present only for integer values of n. N must be an integer, it must be an integer. As we are seeing these concepts for the very first time, therefore we will be discussing all the things in detail, that this n must be an integer, that is this m discrete time signal will be present only for the integer values of n. If you are getting any non-integer values of n, then the discrete time signal will not be defined at that instant. So let it is for n is equals to minus 1, here n is equals to minus 2. So it is the representation which is known to be as graphical representation. If you want to see the mathematical expression of the same signal, if you see the second representation, that is mathematical representation, then you, what you do is, you just write values of x of n from left to right. You just have to move from left to right and write down all the amplitudes of this signal x of n, and then mention the value of corresponding n according to that sample. That is, if you are going to write the values of x of n, then the values are 2.1, then the next value is minus 1, then the next value is 1.8, it is minus 1, then 1.8, then the next value is 2.4, and the next value is minus 1, again the next and last value is 2. So now you will have to mention the value of n for which the amplitude has these values. So if you see here, value 2.1 is occurring for n is equals to minus 2. Therefore, you must have to write here, value of x of n is 2.1 for n is equals to minus 2. Similarly, it is for n is equals to minus 1. This value is at origin. This value is for n is equals to 1. It is for n is equals to 2, and this value is for n is equals to 3. So it is the second type of representation that is known to be the mathematical representation of a discrete time signal. So what you have done here, you have just taken the amplitudes, all of the amplitudes present in the signal from left to right. You have write down all the values of these amplitudes. You have written all the values of amplitudes, and then you have mentioned the values of n corresponding to that amplitude. Next, if you see, similar to the mathematical representation, the third representation that we will be frequently using throughout our syllabus to save time as well as to increase our efficiency, or you can say accuracy, you will have to use the third method that is known to be the sequence representation. For sequence representation, what you just have to do is, again you have to write the values of x of n, that is the amplitudes of x of n. You just start writing amplitudes of x of n in a table, that is, let it is, the values are 2.1, starting from left to right, again you have to write 2.1, then minus 1, then the next value is 1.8, next value is 2.4, next value is minus 1, then next value is 2. So now you have written all of the sample values of x of n, but how we can address that this 1.8 is occurring for which value of n? So to define the values of n, you just mention the origin, that is, the value at the origin is to be mentioned using an arrow. If you say that origin at n equals to 0, the value is 1.8, so what you have to do is, you just have to take an arrow mark at the place of origin. This arrow indicates that this is the sample value at n equals to 0. So if it is the value at n equals to 0, then obviously before n equals to 0, as n can only be the integer, so there here the value of n must be equals to minus 1, here the value of n must be equals to minus 2. Similarly, it is the value for n is equals to 1, it is for n is equals to 2, and it is for n equals to 3. Now if you see here, if we say that the leftmost point where n is existing, let this n is known to be n1, leftmost value of n, let it is named to be n1. Similarly, the rightmost value of n, let it is said to be n2. What we have written? We have first represented the sequence representation of signal, and then we have mentioned the leftmost value of n to be n1 and the rightmost value of n to be n2. If you have obtained the values of n1 and n2, that is, in this case, n1 is minus 2 and n2 is plus 3. So if you have the knowledge of N1 and N2, then you can define the number of samples contained in that discrete time signal. So if you have to find number of samples in a discrete time sequence, number of samples, then this number of samples is going to be N2 minus N1 and plus 1. It is important thing that we will be discussing in further lectures also. If you have to find out the number of samples present in any discrete time signal, then what you have to do is just indicate that, then just define the values of N1 and N2, and if you have defined the values of N1 and N2, then the number of samples would be N2 minus N1 plus 1. As for this example, N2 is 3, therefore it will be 3 minus, N1 is minus 2, therefore 3 minus of minus 2, and then we have to take plus 1. So it will be 3 plus 2, that is 5, plus 1, that is equals to 6. So if you count here, the number of samples in X of N will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. So you can see here, there are 6 number of samples present in X of N, and the number of non-zero samples or number of samples in X of N, you can directly find out using this result. Number of samples equals to N2 minus N1 plus 1, that is equals to 6 in this case. So now we will be discussing some operations, and we will be seeing what are the significance of these operations, what are meaning of the operations that you are going to perform on any continuous or discrete time signal. So we will be taking simultaneously continuous as well as discrete time signals, and we will be performing all of the operations. So before performing operations, if we see two things, that will whenever we will be performing some operation, then we will be seeing it's the operation of the effect of that operation on various parameters of signals. First we will see effect on area, then we will see effect on time duration, that is if the signal was earlier existing for a time t1, then after performing that operation, is there going to be any change in the time duration. So there will be some parameters on which we will be taking the effects of various operation. So to see, there are two things that we have to recall, that is if we see first for continuous time signal, if we say continuous time signal, if we are taking any continuous time signal x of t, then the first thing that the area of this signal x of t, area of this signal x of t is what? You know that the basic, from the basic definition of integration, when in class 11th or 12th, whenever you will be starting your integration, then you have defined it area under the curve. So if you have to find out the value of area of x of t, then you just have to integrate the value of function x of t from minus infinity to plus infinity. If you just integrate x of t dt, taking limits from minus infinity to plus infinity, then this value will give you the area under the curve of x of t. X of t is what? Any continuous time function. Let it is x of t, which is existing for time t, it is signal x of t having value, let it is value 2, existing from let 4 to 10. Let it is a signal x of t. Then if you have to find out the area, then as it is a rectangle, so what you can do is, for rectangle, it is the width. Width is 6, width is equals to 6, and it is height of the rectangle, and the height is going to be 2. So the rectangle area, the area of this rectangle will be width into height, that is equals to 2 into 6, that is equals to 12. So it is the basic process. Now if you want to check this formula, if you have to evaluate the area of this signal x of t, then mathematically what you can do elsewhere is, you have to integrate this signal x of t with respect to t from minus infinity to plus infinity. Now we have taken this example only because here in the formula we have to take integration from minus infinity to plus infinity. But most of the cases you will see that the signal is not existing from minus infinity to plus infinity. So what you do here, you will be taking the limits of this integration from the duration for which signal x of t is existing. So if you see here, if you have to calculate the area of this signal x of t, then you will have to take the limits of integration, because you can see here, before t is equals to 4 or after t is equals to 10, the signal is going to be 0. Therefore you just need to take these limits as integration from 4 to 10. This signal is existing from 4 to 10, therefore it will be 4 to 10. In between this value, from 4 to 10 seconds, the value of signal is constant to be at 2. Therefore, at the place of x of t, we are writing 2 into dt. We just have to integrate 2 for the duration 4 to 10 seconds. Therefore, as it is constant, so it can be taken outside. Integration of t will give you, integration of dt will give you t. And if you put values of t from 4 to 10, therefore it will be 10 minus 4, that is 6, and 6 into 2, you will be getting 12. So we have just seen here that the area of this rectangle is going to be 12. So whenever you have to find out area of any continuous time signal, then you just have to take integration of the signal for all the duration for which it is existing. Therefore, we have written here minus infinity to plus infinity. It will get changed according to the signal, existence of the signal. These limits will be according to the existence of the signal. Then you have to write down the mathematical expression of this, that signal x of t in between these integrals. Like in this case, the signal was constant at 2 for this duration 4 to 10. Therefore, we have substituted the value of x of t to be 2. So it is the process to find area of signal x of t. But you must have to be careful whenever you are using two words, area and absolute integrability. If you have to check absolute integrability of any signal, that whether any particular continuous time signal is absolutely integrable or not, then you are not going to take this x of t integration. Then you define absolute integrability. Absolute integrability. A signal is said to be absolute integrability. Next point is absolute integrability. A signal is said to be absolutely integrable if and only if you evaluate the integral minus infinity to plus infinity, not only x of t, but now we are going to take magnitude of x of t dt. If you evaluate the integral minus infinity to infinity, magnitude of x of t dt, and if this value is less than infinity, if this value is finite, if this value is finite, that is, if this value is less than infinity, then this signal x of t is said to be, then this signal x of t is said to be absolutely integrable. Absolutely integrable. So these are two concepts that must not be merged together. That is, sometimes in hurry you can calculate for absolute checking the, you are going to check absolute integrability, but in hurry you can take integration from minus infinity to x infinity x of t dt, then the result will not be correct. For check and absolute integrability, you must have to integrate from minus infinity to plus infinity magnitude of x of t dt. If it is less than infinity, then you say that this signal x of t is absolutely integrable. Similarly, if you are discussing discrete time signal, whatever we have discussed here, it is for continuous time signal. If you take a case of discrete time signal, then area of discrete time signal x of n. Area of x of n is equals to, let you are having a signal x of n that is having values, let it is plus 2, minus 1, let it is for x of n, let it is next value is 3, then the value is 2 and the value is 1. Let it is your x of n signal with respect to n, the values are 1, 2, minus 1, minus 2 and so on. If you have to find out the area of the signal x of n, then that word area of x of n here also represents, as in case of continuous time signal you have taken integration, but in case of discrete time signal, which is defined only at integer values of n, therefore you will have to take summation of this signal x of n. Again, the summation would be from minus infinity to plus infinity. That is, if you have to define area of x of n, then you will have to take summation of signal x of n from n equals to minus infinity to plus infinity. It is nothing but sum of all the samples of x of n. That is, if you are going to sum all the samples of x of n, then you are going to get area of that discrete time signal x of n. So if you substitute all the values of x of n, then it will be 2 plus minus 1 plus 3 plus 2 and plus 1. Therefore, it will be 3 minus 1, that is 2, plus 3, 5, plus 2, 7, plus 1, 8 square units. So if you have to find area of signal x of n, then you just have to take sum of all of its amplitudes, that is plus 2, minus 1, plus 3, plus 2 and plus 1. It will give you the area of signal x of n. Again, if you have to check absolute summability, now in this case we define the word absolute summability, then you write, if summation from n is equals to minus infinity to plus infinity magnitude of x of n signal, is less than infinity. Again, you have used the word magnitude. If you have to check absolute summability or absolute integrability, then you must not forget this magnitude term. So if you are going to take magnitudes, summation of magnitudes of x of n, and if the magnitude summation is less than infinity, that is, if this LHS term is finite, then you say that this signal x of n is absolutely, then you say that this signal x of n is absolutely summable. It is absolutely summable. So if you see, if you have to take amplitudes, magnitude of amplitudes, if you have to take summation from n equals to minus infinity to infinity x of n magnitude, then what would be for this case? You just have to take magnitude of all the sample values. Like if here the amplitude is minus 1, then the magnitude will be 1 only. That is, if you have to consider the absolute summability, then you just have to take positive values for all the samples. Either it is negative or positive, you must have to take only positive sign with all the samples. Therefore, for magnitude, if you take the summation, again this limit minus infinity to plus infinity implies that all of the samples must be summed. Therefore, if this signal, for this signal, we can write this summation from minus 2 to plus 2 as the signal is 0 before n is equals to minus 2, and the signal is 0 for n greater than minus 2. So while analyzing area, you can change this limits from minus 2 to plus 2, you will be having the same value. Similarly, for here also, if you are evaluating this absolute summability for this signal, then you can change this limits from minus 2 to plus 2 as the signal is 0 outside that interval, and correspondingly you will have to take only positive values of all the samples to define absolute integrability or summability. So you will be having plus 2, plus, plus 1, plus 3, plus 2 and plus 1, that is equals to 3 plus 3 6 plus 2 8 plus 1, that is 9. So it will be 9. It is 1 plus 3 4 plus 2 6 plus 1, it will be 7. So it will be 7, and now it is 9. So what you have done is, if you have to take absolute, if you have to check absolute summability, then you must have to consider magnitude of that value, sample values. Therefore, all of the samples will be taken as positive only. So till now, we have just discussed two basic types, that is continuous time signals and discrete time signals. For continuous time signals, you have told that that signal will be present at every instant of time, and the value can be either integers or it can be a fractional value. The time instance can also be the integer or fractional value. But for discrete time signals, you have said that the signal will now be present only at some integer multiples of TS duration, that is, that is expressed as n is equals to 1, 2, 3 integer values. And if the signal is digital, then its amplitude would be integers only. But if the signal is discrete time analog signal, then its amplitudes can have fractional value also, that as we have taken in our example. So now we can move to the heart of, you can say, your subject that will be used, this topic that we are going to cover will be used in each and every topic, each and every, you can say, lecture that we will be discussing from now onwards, that is your operations on signals. And from the very basic points of function, you will be taking very easy examples of function to understand actually the process of operation, how you perform operation, and what are going to be the effects of these operations on any signal. So let's start with the new chapter. Thank you.